Good morning.
Good morning.
We'll get started as soon as everyone gets in. So I'm Dr. Cindy Miller, President of the World Affairs Council, and on behalf of Dr. Hart, the Chair of Great Decisions, and the rest of the Council, welcome to another Great Decisions. I'd like you to remind you to turn off your cell phones, and also, and again, like with all the speakers, if there's any trouble hearing, just raise your hand. We talked about it beforehand, because you know how sometimes it's easy to step away from the mic and not realize it, and it's only if you guys say something do we know that we've gone too far out of range. For those new to Great Decisions, it's the largest grassroots input on matters of international relations and foreign policy in the world. During the year, these kind of sessions happen all across the United States to provide an opportunity to influence American foreign policy with educating yourself and also the ballots that you can do online. There's a link in your program. The Council would like to thank the Norfolk Commission on the Arts and Humanities for a generous grant to support Great Decisions, and Dr. David Resselman and Norfolk Academy for hosting the event. We would also like to thank our corporate sponsors listed in your program, which include Penrod, Bay Diesel, and SunTrust Bank, among others. With their support, they've demonstrated commitment to the community, education, and the global standing Hampton Roads. We've got some great events coming up, and I hope you'll be able to attend. We've got on Thursday, March 8th, Slover Library, Dr. Trita Parsi, founder and current president of the National Iranian American Council and author. He's a very engaging person, so I hope you'll come out. It should be a very informative, but also very engaging and entertaining and sometimes event. If he's able to put up with Jon Stewart and Colbert, you can see him online if you want. He's been on there before, and he did great there. And I've heard great things about him from other Iranian experts. And then Thursday, March 22nd at Old Dominion University, Ambassador Daniel Freed, he'll have a conversation with us about the state of world affairs. He's the longest serving ambassador at State Department. He just retired in 2017. He served 4 decades and for 7 presidents. So he has a plethora of insights that he can share with us. And so we're going to try to do sort of like a global view, not really focused on one title. We're still working through it, what the title of the event was. And now I'm delighted to introduce our speaker, who's going to help us inform our understanding of China and its entangled and very complicated relationship with the United States. Dr. Kathy Wu is an assistant professor at the Department of Political Science and Geography and Graduate Program of International Studies at Old Dominion University. She received a doctorate earned a doctorate in government from the University of Texas, a master's of political science at the University of Colorado, and a bachelor's in international politics from Peking University in China. She studies the roles of domestic politics and international relations and foreign relations of East Asia. So please welcome Dr. Wu.
Thank you, Cindy, for a generous introduction. I was told that I had a low voice, small voice, so if you didn't hear me clearly, please make sure you raise your hands so that I will know. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming here. So today we are going to talk something about China and especially about the Belt and Road Initiative. And I guess 1 year ago, if you ask people outside of China or East Asia what the Belt and Road Initiative was, and many of them would have no idea what you were talking about. But then just 2 days ago, I think on Thursday, yes, the U.S.-China Economic and Security Review Commission just conducted a hearing about the China's Belt and Road Initiative. And this just shows you how fast this initiative has been influential, has been increased, the influence of this initiative has been increasing in the past year. And so this map is the ancient route, the land route and the sea route of the ancient China's of the ancient Silk Road. And so on top right, is there, This is a black spot next to the Taiwan island. And this is actually where I grew up before college. And I remember very, very well that for years, our local government was trying very hard in promoting our city as the starting point of the Maritime Silk Road and competing with those neighboring cities for that title. And I was always very cynical about that, because back then, even in China, maybe Chinese people would be familiar with the land route of ancient Silk Road, but if you ask them about the Maritime Silk Road, again, no one knew what you were talking about. But look at what happened now. Thanks to the current Belt and Road Initiative, actually my city is getting more and more mentions and references domestically and even internationally. So I should probably take my cynical attitudes back and really congratulate our mayors from constantly making efforts in promoting and in believing in it. So if you keep believing in something, that may actually come true one day. So that's the lesson I learned. So, but we are not going to talk about the ancient Silk Road today. We are going to focus on the current one in the 21st century. So what, there are many perspectives to think about this initiative and talk about it, and we can totally do that during the Q&A session. But what I want to emphasize today is to show you the domestic context of this Belt and Road Initiative. So we are going to talk about what it is, where it came from, what the Chinese government wanted to achieve from this initiative, and what the current status is, and some of those, some of the potential challenges. And finally, we are going to think about what that may imply to the United States. So this domestic orientation may partially come from my own research interest, as you hear from Cindy, that when I tend to see, when I see a foreign policy, I like to think about what the domestic origin is. And I also like to see what kind of domestic impact it wants to achieve, given that certain foreign policy. But more importantly, in the context of China, I want to argue that it's actually, you must kind of understand what Chinese domestic politics context is in order to understand any important foreign policy or foreign relations in China. And here's why, and mostly it's related to the nature of leadership in CCP. So regardless of how popular the CCP has been currently or in the past two decades, one of the most fundamental concerns for CCP is always the regime survival. And CCP has figured out in the past 3 or 4 decades, as long as it can achieve economic growth and increase China's international influence, is going to be able to secure wide popular support. So the key concerns are going to be how CCP is going to sustain economic growth and keep promoting China's international status globally. And because of that fundamental concern of survival, and you are going to see the party controls almost any aspect that it chooses to control. And so if you see any area that has weak party influence, it's either because the party chooses not to do so, the party chooses not to intervene, mostly for the purpose of economic growth, or the party has not yet recognized the importance, or the party has not yet figured out one way to intervene, such as maybe the internet or social media like 10 years ago. But this does not happen now. And of course, there's no separation of power, right? So I know we might be concerned about the current administration, but still in this country, we still see the robustness of the separation of power, even in this administration. But in China, party actually rules all, party leads all. And this slogan that party rules all, party leads all, It has just been reiterated last year in the recent 19th Party Congress. And if I remember it correctly, it's going to be written in the new version of Chinese constitution. And to add more uncertainty to China's foreign relations, we also need to think about the less stable and institutionalized transitions of leadership. So it adds just more uncertainty to China's foreign relations. So therefore, I'm going to make the case that even though domestic politics would be important in any foreign relations in any context, but maybe in the case of China, domestic factors are going to play a more immediate and direct factors in understanding China's foreign relations. And this framework, I think I can apply to the past four decades, which began from 1978. That was the beginning of China's reform and economic openness. And this year actually marks the 40th anniversary of China's reform and economic openness. So I think to better understand where China is now, we can sort of look at how China's international position has evolved in the past four decades as associated with China's GDP growth. Right, so this is the GDP, China's GDP from 1978 to 2016-2017. And from 1978 to 1992, Deng Xiaoping was the actual leader, even though he has never got that title as China's president. And during this period, China just began its economic reform. And so the domestic challenges is how to maintain a sustainable economic reform and how to open the market to and how to trade more with the foreign market. So one key thing in, that implies to foreign relations is that Deng was implementing the principle of non-alignment. And he was trying to keep distance from Mao's internationalist style that tried to compete with Soviet Union for the leadership in a communist camp. So during this period, Deng was trying to improve relationship, not just with neighboring countries, but also with major Western powers, and in order to trade as many countries as possible. From 1992 to 2002, the leadership shifted to Mr. Jiang Zemin. And he faces two major tasks during his terms. The first one is obviously how to continue and to further China's economic reform and openness. And the other is really try to recover China's relationship with major Western powers after the Tiananmen incident. Right, so you would, during this period, you heard lots of term like mentions about strategic partnership, and that is Mr. Jiang's efforts in trying to recover and maintain a comprehensive relationship with major Western powers such as United States, France, Britain, and Germany, and among many others. And also during this period, we began to hear something called China's threat. And that is partially because the continual growth of China's economy, also because the effect that coming out of the Tiananmen incident. So Western society was very worried about what China would be in the future. Could China be a threat to the liberal world? So that was the challenges and Mr. Jiang Zemin was facing. And so from 2002 to 2012, there was another leader called Mr. Hu Jintao. So during this period, although from this chart, we are going to see that China's economy was continuing to grow, but China also faced new domestic problems, such as the increasing inequality domestically, and also the lack of social welfare and all other social problems associated with those. And so, once again, Mr. Hu Jintao had to continue and further economic reform and openness. And on the other hand, so another key is very important is try to maintain a very peaceful international environment. And that was the key for China's economic growth. And but from the outside, because of the China's economy was continuing to grow, that raised some serious concerns among neighboring countries, especially the country in Southeast Asia. That was almost the first time from the perspective of Southeast Asian countries that they saw the re-emergence of China since probably the late 19th century. They have never seen the re-emergence of a great nation in this region again. So they were concerned about how China would do with, for example, the South China Sea. So during this period, what Hu Jintao was trying to do is trying to reassure those neighboring countries that, okay, we might be growing continually, but we are going to rise peacefully. So you heard a lot about China's peaceful rise during this period, and there are lots of articles from scholars and politicians trying to make the case that why and how China would be rising peacefully. But another voice also emerged, also mostly from the United States actually. During this period, you began to hear that some US leaders began to consider China as a stakeholder of the international system that the United States invented and maintained since the end of World War II. And so the United States wanted, okay, we cannot prevent China from going, so why not try to incorporate China into the system of the liberal world, and so can treat China or persuade China to be a stakeholder to the current international system. I thought it was someone told me that you cannot hear me. That's fine. You can hear me, good. But this kind of stakeholder persuasion was not very well received by Mr. Hu Jintao, because actually both Jiang Zemin and Hu Jintao, they follow very closely through Deng's instruction, which is trying to keep a low file in China's foreign relations. That was one of the most fundamental guidelines of China's foreign policy since the end of Tiananmen incident, and it went through two leaders. Yes?
Can you keep looking this way?
Oh, yes.
Absolutely.
Yes, thank you. And then, so basically what that means is that they are trying to, even though China was rising and it was has no interest in working as a leader, working as a national leader, at least during whose administration. And so this is changing now, as we see in the current administration. Right, so now Xi Jinping, not formally, but very explicitly abandoned the principle of keeping a low profile. And so what he emphasized is so-called big power diplomacy was Chinese characteristics. And just as many CCP slogans that no one exactly knows what that means as big power diplomacy was Chinese characteristics. But it's very clear that Mr. Xi Jinping has been more confident and ambitious in promoting China's leadership in the world. And he has, and this is very, very different from the previous leader. So this trend looks quite powerful, smooth, and probably a little bit intimidating, right? But I'm going to argue that this is not the full picture. Because if you look at the economic growth rate, China definitely experienced ups and downs, right? So sometimes economic growth was accelerating and sometimes it was slowing down. And every time that I'm going to show here, every time when China has experienced economic downturn, we are going to see a rise in social movements. And also we are going to see the government in order to deal with the social potential social movements, as well as economic downturn, the government always come up with some initiatives or strategies to deal with economic problems and hopefully to get China's economy take off again. I apologize for the small font, but I will explain every single thing. So the first major economic downturn in the mid-1980s, and that led to the first wave of student movements in the 1980s. So students were not very happy about the rate of unemployment, and one solution they came up with is, okay, we need to push forward the political reforms. And that marked the beginning of the student movements in the late 1980s. And that led to the tragic Tiananmen incident in 1989. And so since then, no improvement was allowed or permitted for promoting or requesting political reforms, as everyone knows. But this Tiananmen incident also reminded CCP that if the CCP could not come up with an alternative political foundation, as it can no longer rely on communist ideology or personal charisma, this is not going to work. As long as the China CCP cannot find an alternative political foundation, and that's why they turn to nationalism or patriotism as an alternative political foundation that they can still appeal to Chinese people. And that is why in 1999, you see Beijing began its first bid for Beijing for the Olympic Games. And that just trying to boost nationalism and also show to the world that China's willingness and determination to go back to the international, to go back to the international stage. However, this initiative failed, but still it does the job in terms of promoting nationalism and boosting the national morale as well. So the second economic downturn in the mid-1990s, and this was associated with the privatization of state-owned enterprises, and again that led to a higher rate of unemployment, and because of a lack of social welfare, so lots of people who lose their job and did not get enough social welfare, so again, that raise the potential for social movements. And obviously no political reform was allowed, and CCP was closely monitor any anti-government sentiments or movements. But what CCP was doing is that it started to tolerating anti-foreign nationalistic movements. So in 1999, when US bombed the Chinese embassy in Belgrade, so China's government actually tolerated and somehow facilitated the anti-US protest in Beijing and in many other major cities in China. But as we are going to see later, CCP was very well aware that tolerating nationalist movements is just going to work very temporarily. So eventually, China has to come up with another fundamental solution to deal with economic problems. And that is why in the same year, China was actually able to make a major breakthrough with the United States when negotiating the terms about China's entry into WTO. And that just cleared the major barrier for China's entry into WTO. And also in 1998, Beijing began its second bid for Beijing for the Olympic Games, and that this time Beijing actually succeeded. And we are now in the third major economic downturn that China is experiencing. And so we also see something similar that China's government tolerated, even though also closely monitored the anti-Japanese protest in 2012. Hearing was the Diaoyu Island incident in East China Sea. And one thing that is also related and is a major topic for our presentation today is the Belt Road Initiative that Mr. Xi Jinping initiated in 2013. And so from this ups and down chart, we can kind of see that in every economic downturn, that even though on the one hand, China's government may be tolerating social movements related to anti-foreign protest, but CCP was quite well aware that this is not going to work in the long run. And this is actually going to increase the risk of regional confrontation, which goes completely against the fundamental principle of China's foreign relations, which is creating a peaceful international environment for China's economic growth. So CCP knows that, okay, in order to deal with this fundamental economic problems, they may have to find some alternatives, and they may have to shift some strategies, and that means shifting strategies domestically and internationally in order to sustain the regime survival, which is the ultimate goal. And in my opinion, that this is the whole domestic motivation of the Belt and Road Initiative. So Belt and Road Initiative is considered as a China's grand strategy, meaning that this is not just going to be implemented in within 1 or 2 years. Ideally, at least in Xi Jinping's mindset, this is going to be implemented in the next 5 or 10 years at least. And it's trying to sustain China's economic growth and also raise China's international influence, the two main primary concerns of CCP. And relatedly, you can see from the name, this is also trying to restore the glorious past of China, ancient China, right? Because the whole Belt and Road Initiative was just trying to revive the ancient Silk Road, and which basically marked the, arguably, during that period when the ancient Silk Road was most prosperous, and that was the period when the ancient China was arguably the most powerful country in the world, and with high degrees of openness. And that was the status, this is the status that Chinese people wanted to return back, and also CCP promised its people to get back to. And of course, this Belt and Road Initiative, just similar to many initiatives from previous leaders, it definitely has some very unique footprint and legacy of Xi Jinping himself. So as I mentioned before, he is definitely more ambitious and confident in promoting China's international leadership. And even though this initiative was created in or discussed in 2012 and 2013, and because Xi's power was not consolidated yet during this period, he had to spend another 2 or 3 years through anti-corruption campaigns and other methods to fully consolidate his power. And that's why we started to see acceleration of the Belt and Road Initiative since last year, right, after Xi has finally consolidated his power. Okay, so what exactly the Belt and Road Initiative is? So there are two parts, right? So one is the land route called the Silk Road Economic Belt, and that basically covers the land route from China through Central Asia, West Asia, and hopefully to all the way to Western Europe. And the second part is the 21st century maritime Silk Road. And that basically just trying to connect Africa and Europe through Southeast Asia and South Asia. So there are two parts that constitute the Belt and Road Initiative. And so basically on the surface, it's just about a network of all kinds of infrastructure projects, such as railroads, highways, oil and gas pipelines, and ports. But You're going to hear more and more discussion about the geopolitical importance that may reveal more clearly in the long run. And for now, we can already see how connectivity, what a degrees of connectivity Chinese government was trying to achieve through this Belt and Road Initiative. So far, 65 countries have signed the agreement to participate in the Belt and Road Initiative. This was still at the early stage. And just show you how the scale of the 65 countries. So it accounted for nearly 40% of land area and 62% of population, 30% of GDP, and 24% of the world household consumption. And again, this list, according to China's official media, is going to continue to grow. I think last year, the current data, according to the Xinhua news agency, the Chinese official agency, this list has been growing to 70 countries already. Okay, so why do we see this Belt and Road Initiative? Where is this background? So why, for example, watching reservoirs, and why focusing on infrastructure networks, not something else, not about trade or like something else? So there are lots of discussion about a political and economic background, and I'm just going to highlight two key figures that are behind this Belt and Road Initiative. The first person, his name is Mr. Wang Jisi, so Wang is the last name. So he's a professor in Peking University, and he's a very influential figure in the making of major Chinese foreign policy, not just during Xi's administration, but actually in the past administrations as well. So in 2012, he published an article, both in Chinese and English. You can actually find it in English, which is titled Marching Westward, the Rebalancing of China's Geo Strategy. So in this article, he proposed something called Marching Westward as a domestically driven international strategy. So he wanted to highlight this as an extension of the Western development strategy. So the Western development strategy is a domestic development strategy initiated by Mr. Jiang Zemin around late 1990s in order to promote economic growth in the Western area, mainly northwest area and also southwestern area in China, to deal with the economic imbalances between the eastern coast, eastern area, and western area. And so Mr. Wang Jisi is trying to make this strategy extended to Central Asia and Western Asia and to connect with those countries in the region, and trying to argue that this is a good way for promote economic growth for the Western area, and also try to deal with the separatist and terrorist activities, especially in the northern Western area of China. But in this article, he also mentioned that this is also from the geopolitical perspective. This marching west, this direction of marching westward, is also trying to avoid direct confrontations with the United States. Especially during the Obama administration, Obama actually initiated a new strategy called Pivot to Asia, right? And so, according to Mr. Wang, that marching westward is allowing China to further economic growth without confronting directly with the United States. And in his article, one of the very interesting points that I find is that he urges Chinese people, Chinese leaders, to rethink China as a middle kingdom. And this is very interesting because in Chinese language, if you know Chinese a little bit, the meaning of China is the middle kingdom. And Wang argues that for a very, very long time, China was actually a land power rather than a maritime power. It was only until very recently, by dealing with United States and other neighboring powers, that China began to see itself as a potential power or regional power in the Asian Pacific region. But if you look at the ancient history of China, China has always been a land power in the Middle Kingdom, right? So it's not just about moving eastward. And the ancient China actually has very close relationship with those countries and regions in the West. And that is why Wang argues that China does not really have to moving eastward if that actually leads to direct confrontations with the United States. And I just quote one of his arguments here, that China does not need to limit itself to first becoming an ancient Pacific power, then becoming a global power. Right, so that's his argument, that kind of pointing out the direction of where he believes China needs to go to further international growth and engagement. And the other person, Mr. Professor Justin Yifu Lin. So he is an economist and also professor at Peking University and former chief economist in World Bank. So he did lots of studies in understanding China's economic success and also how developing countries can promote economic growth. And so he has an article trying to argue that, and several others trying to argue that why China succeeded economically, and also how he believes China can help developing countries to promote economic growth as well. And so according to him, that China's economic succeeded mainly because China was able to take advantage of backwardness, meaning that China did not have to start from scratch as what Britain or United States had to do during the Industrial Revolution. So China can actually observe those Western technologies and grows much faster since the 1970s. And also China took full advantage of this comparative advantage and benefited strongly from the international trade. But there are also some challenges that China is facing, meaning like how China can continue to grow by investing continuously and benefiting from it, benefit from strong growth in investment, and also how to address this income inequalities. And this becomes a major problem, especially if you look at this chart. We're not going to go through everything, but what I want to emphasize here is in the 1990s, just look at this pink portion. This is the percentage of machinery and transport equipment that accounts for the portion of Chinese exports. This was only accounted for 17.3% in 1990. And 20 years later, it has grown to 47.3%. The machinery and transport equipment, right? So this is just trying to show you that China actually has a very excessive capacity of production that Chinese leaders have headache about how to deal with that. Initially, they try to increase domestic consumption, but turns out it's not working very well. And then China wanted to invest in developed countries, right, by purchasing US debts and other measures. But after the financial crisis, again, this has proved not very effective to gain benefits from this kind of investment. So Lin was proposing that China's to invest infrastructure projects in developing countries. And also, he tried to initiate it that China needs to lead initiative in a global structural transformation fund and to lend money to developing countries and then to help them to get the money to build infrastructure projects. And that is how he believed that it's a win-win situation, because on the one hand, by exporting more and more infrastructure projects, that China can finally reduce some of its excessive capacity of production overseas. And on the other hand, Professor Lin believes that the infrastructure gap is the bottleneck that prevented developing countries from growing. And so once those developing countries have all these facilities of infrastructure projects, they are able to grow their economy, develop their economy very healthily in the long run. So that for him is a win-win situation for both China and developing countries. And so Professor Wang basically proposed like the direction of where China needs to go, marching westwards. And Professor Lin basically trying to argue that, okay, we need to emphasize, China needs to emphasize in investing infrastructure networks in developing countries and initiated a global structural transformation fund. And that is very similar to the AIIB, the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank that we see nowadays. So this is just trying to show you the current status of BRI, the Belt and Road Initiative. Again, we only have 2 years so far, and it's still very early to see how far this initiative can go. But I'm just going to show you a couple of current status. So first of all, last November, the Belt and Road Initiative was written in the party charter after the 19th Party Congress. And this indicates CCP really considered this Belt and Road Initiative as a long-term strategy that is not just about, say, specific infrastructure projects, and it actually pointed out kind of a grand strategy that CCP or Chinese government wanted to pursue in the long run. And so the estimate investment in total is going to be $1 trillion or $1.3 trillion US dollars. According to scholars and many resources. And so far, there are a couple of railway projects that are either planned or under construction. I'm just going to show you two major ones. So the first one is through China, like southwest part of China, to Laos and Thailand and Malaysia and all the way to Indonesia. And the other one that is also planned is from the west, northwest China through Central Asia and all the way through Iran and Turkey, and hopefully it will expand it to Western Europe. So these two major high-speed railway projects are currently planned and under construction right now. And another major, like a flagship project, due to the close relationship between China and Pakistan, is the so-called China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. And this is not just about infrastructure projects, and I think China was also working with the Pakistan government in trying to establish several special economic zones, just as when China established four special economic zones in the 1980s. And the whole Economic Corridor project would involve $60 billion worth of infrastructure projects. And again, although we are still in the early stage, but there's some data already show that China, the trade between China and BRI partners were increasing 15% last year compared to 2016. And so, this project obviously involved lots of capital. And where does all this money come from? Right? And ideally, the money is going to come from the combination of multilateral organizations and some China-based fund. The first one is going to be the AIIB, Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. So this bank, although it was initiated by China, is the nature of this bank is going to be a multilateral international organization, just as, say, the Asian Development Bank, led by Japan, or the World Bank, or International Monetary Fund. And so it operated in December 2015 with 57 funding members. Initial capital was $100 billion. So China has the major voting shares, but the percentage of voting share is not dominant because of many other members. And the other multilateral organization is BRIC, New Development Bank. And so this was another development bank that was initiated by for the BRICS, Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa as well. And the other major source of funding comes from the Silk Road Fund, established in December 2014. And this is a fund, though mainly based on China's foreign wealth fund. But this fund also opens for some private capital as well. And the initial capital, and I think China so far has invested $55 billion. And finally, we are going to see lots of investment from China's domestic policy banks and commercial banks as well. So such as China's Development Bank and also China Export and Import Bank. So that was the ideal picture, right? And you see from the amount of US dollars, ideally that the major fund is going to come from the multilateral investment bank and some from policy banks of China and some from the Silk Road Fund. But at least for now, because AIIB was just initiated, Silk Road Fund was just initiated, and BRICS New Development Bank is going to be very uncertain about how much this bank is going to involve because of the resistance of India about this whole BRIC and BRO, Belt and Road initiative. So in reality, at least for now, what we are seeing here is the dominant source of funding that comes from China's policy banks, like China Development Bank, and the four major state-owned commercial banks of China. In 2016, so these are the China policy banks and commercial banks actually accounted for the major funding sources of the Belt and Road Initiative. And maybe in the next three or five years, we are going to see the growing importance of AIIB in the future. But I think in the short run, we are going to see the dominance of China's policy banks and commercial banks in funding those projects, those BRI projects. And that leads to the next point, which is, and this is related to how the Belt and Road Initiative is actually, in my opinion, an international solution to China's domestic problems, that in those projects funded by Chinese resources, we're going to see Chinese companies are going to have a unique advantage in receiving those contracts and in building infrastructure projects in those developing countries compared to the projects funded by multilateral banks. Right? This is the data from the CSIS think tank that according to their data from 2006 to 2018, that 80% of China-funded projects are going to be conducted, are going to be implemented by Chinese companies. While if you look at the projects funded by multilateral bank, funded by multilateral banks, only 29% of those projects are implemented by Chinese companies. There are different sides about how to interpret these charts. On one hand, I think it's arguably correct that Chinese companies do have some advantages in building those infrastructure projects due to their long-term experiences in China. So they may actually have some advantages in competing for these projects. But it also shows you that they have a unique and possibly unequal advantage in those China-funded projects. And that just related to Professor Lin's point that through this Belt and Road project that mostly funded by China, that is Chinese government is going to be able to transfer some of China's excessive capacity of production to developing countries. And that is exactly show from the data from since 2006, and it's going to continue this trend in the near future. Okay, so we have talked a lot about the domestic regions of this Belt and Road Initiative, but to what extent the Belt and Road Initiative is going to create the domestic impact, expected by the Chinese government has actually a lot to do with international factors. And for example, if the Belt and Road Initiative wants to sustain economic growth, there are two potential risks. One is the debt crisis, right? So China lent all these capitals to developing countries. Ideally, they're not going to be free money, right? China wants them to pay back and gain economic benefits from those investments. But to what extent those developing countries are able to pay back in the long run is questionable. Even though Chinese government can always just write off checks like, fine, you guys don't have to pay back, but if that's the result, and it's not going to generate enough wealth in terms from the perspective of investment, right? And the other potential risk is the financial instability, right? So for now, Chinese government has been very, very conservative and cautious about the free flow of RMB, Chinese currency, to avoid any potential financial risks, something like Asian financial crisis in 1997. But because of these projects, right, you're going to anticipate that lots of Chinese currency are moving forward, moving to the international market, and that just increased the risks of financial instability of Chinese currency. And if this project, or if the BRI is going to continue to raise China's international influence, and it's going to be questionable about how sustainable this project is going to be. If we think about the regional instability, right? Think about this, all these railway projects are going to pass through Iran and Kashmir area and Turkey. So in all these areas, there are huge concerns about regional instability. And if there's a major terrorist events or civil war that took place in those regions, and how far the Belt and Road Initiative can go is seriously questionable. And the other thing that is related to China's international image, and that is potentially, there's going to be potentially some gap between how foreigners or how people in developing countries in those BRI partners perceive China, and versus how Chinese people perceive China themselves. For long, Chinese people perceive China as a peace-loving country, as a positive promotion of development. But if these Belt and Road Initiative are going to create some negative consequences or images about China in those developing countries, that there might be some risks that China would be considered as a predator. It's possible, and if this kind of image, this kind of negative image is not going to create a problem as long as the Chinese government, through official propaganda, official media, that keep this negative image from reaching Chinese people, it's probably going to be fine. But if for some reason those two images somehow clashed, just as what had happened during the torch relay of Chinese of Olympic Games in 2008, that China actually see that Chinese people realized that it was actually not very well received, for example, in Paris and in London, and that is going to create a huge crisis or identity crisis among Chinese people about its own image, and that would just go against the whole rationale about raising China's international influence and as a legitimacy foundation for CCP. And finally, and this is about more about domestic rather than international, and this is Xi's personal legacy, right? And we are going to see how sustainable this project, this initiative is going to be if Xi leaves office in 5 years. And there are already lots of discussion or suspicion about whether Xi is actually going to leave office 5 years later. Is he going to become like China's Putin, that just trying to stay in office for more than 10 years? And this might be good news for Belt and Road Initiative, but if Xi actually follows the previous practice and leaves office in after 5 years, and then it becomes another question to think about whether this Belt and Road Initiative is going to sustain, right? Because if you look at the previous initiatives from former Chinese leaders, it was very popular and it was all over the place when they were in office. But once they left the office, even though some of those initiatives were also written in the party charter, but we are going to see the declining influence of those initiatives once the leaders who created it left the office. So it's still hard to see how far this can go. And finally, we can talk something about what that implies to the United States. And honestly, I don't have a very clear answer, mostly because I'm not very aware of any clear vision or like grand strategy that this current administration has about East Asia in particular. And it's also some concerns about whether the Trump administration is going to be preoccupied by the domestic issues and without enough attention to Asian affairs. But we can sort of think about just hypothetically, right? So if President Trump is going to implement this American first principle, that I think one thing that he might do is trying to facilitate the access of US companies to joining the BRI and to create more opportunities for US companies in participating in the BRI, in the Belt and Road Initiative. And the other two would be related more about coming up with an alternative to compete with or complement with the BRI. Right, so the idea is that to give more options to these developing countries, that they don't only, they to reduce their potential dependence on China, that for now there may be only just one option, that BRI, that if those developing countries want to develop infrastructure projects, this might be, BRI might be the main source that they can turn to. But if the United States government decided to go back to TPP, which I think is unlikely, but if United States wants to go back to TPP or actually reinvest in the current international arrangements and as an alternative to BRI, and that may be able to give those developing countries other options in addition to BRI, and that may be as a way to kind of balance against China, or at least to reduce the dependence of those countries on China. So these might be some potential options for the United States government. And with that, I close my presentation, and I look forward to the Q&A session.